We made USAA for homeowners who like being ready. That's why we have safety tips for things like fires.
Hello, Nizan. Can you hear me okay? What's happening, everybody? Can you guys hear me?
I'm in.
Awesome. Just thought I'd play some music while we're waiting for some people to come on. The Eye of the Tiger is always a classic.
Nice. Can you hear me okay, Nissan? Perfect, because my audio coming back from you is kind of low. It happened today, started working today. I got to figure out what setting I hit.
It's probably because of the music.
Let's try that.
You have a few more minutes, people just checking in.
All right, I'll turn this off. Let's see. All right. What's going on, everybody?
We got some people coming in now. How's it going, Doug?
It is hot.
Out in Arizona, huh?
It's effing hot. I'm sorry. There's no professional way to say it. It's bad.
I hear you.
It's okay. I stay inside.
I hear you.
Yeah, I still need to see a picture of you and dreadlocks, man. I know I've met you before, like 12 years ago. I saw a glimpse of it on someone else's phone at the event in Florida, and I said, I think I met the guy. God, crazy how time flies.
Oh, absolutely.
Isn't this good?
Yep. What's happening, Juan? How are you?
Let's see.
We had a bunch of people register for tonight. That's always good.
Let's see.
How you doing, Juan?
Good. How are you?
Fantastic.
Terrific.
Where are you located?
In Miami-Dade.
Nice.
Yeah.
It must be humid down there, though.
Oh, extremely. It's crazy.
Yeah. It's humid here in Arizona,
that
too.
That time of year.
Yeah.
We've had a heat advisory for the last couple of days as well, so.
We had our first monsoon last night. That was exciting.
Gentlemen, I'm just going to finish my dinner real quick.
Go right ahead.
I'll be right back.
Yeah, go right ahead. Well, we're going to wait a few more minutes because there's a bunch of people coming on and they're texting me. Rock and roll.
Hi, Doug.
Hey, Natalie, how you doing?
Good, you're good. And yourself?
Fantastic. Fantastic.
All right. Interesting. You know, people think they know everything they need to know about 1031s, and then you talk, and then they talk to you for 2 minutes, and they're like, oh, shit, I didn't know all that.
I wish somebody would. I hate this is a statement I don't like getting. I wish somebody would have told me that last week.
Right?
Actually, I forgot to text it to my mom. I hope she's home now.
I want to put the link in the WhatsApp group so that let's see. Well,
I just copied and pasted it. Somebody asked for the link.
Oh, Melissa on the WhatsApp group?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. Yes.
Recording in progress.
I'm sending it to my mom. I forgot to send it to her.
Come on, Mom. Gotta join us.
Yeah. She's the one.
How you doing, Dan?
Oh, echoing. Here, I'll send it.
Awesome. We'll give it another minute and then we'll start. You know, people come in and whatnot, and we'll record this and we'll get it rolling. Am I recording? I don't know. Let's see. Live broadcast. Let's do it live on Facebook. Never done this before. The meeting description. Share on your own timeline. Share to your page. Select page. Hmm. Oh, you know what? Let's do it on my timeline. There we go. Go live. Interesting. Going live on Facebook with it. All right. Well, let's see what happens. Never done that before. All right. Oh, I see that. I see me on Facebook. Okay.
Now we have to behave.
Yeah, right. we gotta talk nicely.
No dirty words.
All right. So let's start recording. Oh, we are recording. All right. Welcome, everybody. I'm Nitzan Mosery. Welcome, everybody. Hope everybody's doing well. Thank you so much for being here. Oh, you know what? I hear myself on the Facebook. Okay. There we go. All right. So welcome again. We've got an incredible guest here tonight. Every week we bring another guest to talk about a different aspect of multifamily real estate. Last week, we did underwriting do's and don'ts. We had a great person on the phone on the call as well, Hitomi. This week, we're talking about when we want to sell our property, what are the best ways to minimize our capital gains? But not only that, how can we get our sellers to actually want to sell the property and do all these kinds of things? And I'll tell you, I had the privilege of doing a live Instagram live with Doug a few weeks back. And within 2 minutes, I learned three new things about 1031 exchanges that I didn't really know about. So without further ado, you guys have questions, write them down. Doug is going to talk quickly. We're going to do a quick session on 1031 exchanges. He's going to talk, and then we'll open it up to Q&A. We're also doing this live on Facebook. So if anybody on Facebook has any questions and whatnot, just write them down in the comment section. I'm checking that out as well. Let me start it off by going hello. Okay. So without further ado, I would like to introduce my awesome guest, Doug Blackwell from Blackwell Equities. And Doug has been doing 1031 exchanges, I think, since 1031 exchanges with 1031s. I think since they started. If you need to know anything about 1031, Doug is the man to go to. And if you see on the in the chat over here on the Zoom, he put down his email and his phone number. So why don't you can grab that. We are recording this, so anybody that's missing it tonight will get a chance to hear Doug talk. So Doug, welcome, and thank you so much for taking time out of the hot Arizona heat to come and stay in some air conditioning weather, you know, in an air conditioned room, and share with us things about 1031 exchanges, right? We all think we know what a 1031 is, right? You go, you want to sell a property, you don't want to pay capital gains, right? But there's intricacies. There are different things that we need to understand about the right way of doing it. And I'm going to open it up for you so that you can start sharing your wisdom and knowledge, and I'm going to be quiet.
Doug, take it away, man. Listen, you're amazing. I really appreciate every time we get together. I had a great time at your event last month. Oh my God, I met so many great people. That was so much fun. And I picked up a few tidbits myself. So it's like a share like, because once you think you know everything, you meet somebody that knows a little more than you and or a little something different. So I'm always humbled and I always take away the nuggets. So I hope that my half hour with you guys today, I can share a few nuggets with you. And I can't make you an expert on 1031 exchange by any means in a short time we're together. But I hope to impress upon you that the internet is not a good friend of yours if you're doing research on 1031s. On the internet. You need to talk to someone like myself. We don't charge for consultations. If you have a question about a property or deal you're doing, whether you're thinking about selling it, whether you think about buying it, you want to structure so that if taxes are at all a concern to you, it's always best to call me before you do something. I don't like getting that statement, I wish somebody would have told me, or why didn't they tell me? So at the end of the day, I've been doing 1031s for only 22 years. So Nissan, thank you for, we've been around for 100. I'm not quite 100 years old yet. I've been doing 1031s for about 22 years, 23 years now. And it's all I've really been doing. It's something I've really had a passion for. It's geeky, but it's my little thing. And so when I put my pedal to the metal, it's on one topic. I'm not going to look left. I'm not going to look right, but I'm going to get you to the end zone. I'm going to get the ball in the net. We're going to have fun with this thing because I want you to understand that there's a lot of things you can do. The internet paints a 1031 exchange as a very black and white, yes or no type thing. We are not. We are a very gray animal, and we are always a maybe. We got to talk about the deal. We got to figure out what's going on, and we could possibly structure something to make it work. I'm going to go over a couple of examples of that towards the end of the presentation. I'm going to talk about seller carry financing and how it could benefit you and your seller, but they may be not wanting to pay the taxes. And I'll explain what seller financing means, some of the things you don't know about it, and some of the things your client doesn't know about it. But if they know what I know, they love it. So at the end of the day, I think that it's one of those things I want to make sure I cover. I'm going to go through the basics of a 1031 exchange. I'm not going to spend a lot of time on it. I just want to give you the quick hazing so you get a quick general knowledge of what's going on, where the pitfalls are, because I'm going to spend a couple minutes on those two topics for you at the end, if that's okay. So I'm going to go ahead and share my screen. I'm going to start off with my presentation that I've had for years. I just keep changing the picture in the background of it. And let me get this thing going here. Hold on a second. Can everybody see that okay? We're good? All right. So what I'm going to start this off, that's my QR code. If you want to grab your phone real quick and take a picture of that, I'll go into your phone the right way. I'll put 1031 strategically in my name. So if you forget my name, it's okay. You just simply type 1031 and I promise to show up. It's been a magical tool for me. And I think it's made me a lot of money by doing that. But go ahead and take that quick picture if you want. And I'm going to send this presentation to Nissan so we can get it out to everybody. So don't worry about taking screenshots and trying to capture everything. I'll send it on over to him so you guys can have a copy of it. So anyway, I'm not trying to be your tax advisor. This is my disclaimer. I'm going to talk about a lot of different things. But really, I don't want to have it constitute tax or legal advice. It's simply guidance on what I'm doing as a 1031 exchange professional and things that are just as I do my business, these are the things that come up. A lot of times people ask me if I am a CPA. I'm not. I'm not an attorney. And that makes it even better because I don't have to worry about those things. I rely on those professionals to make sure they cover all of us. But I know what they're. I know a lot of times what the process is. And I also provide CLE for legal and for CPA, CPE for them. I teach them 1031 exchange as well. So if that makes any difference. Real quick, why we use a 1031 exchange, what qualifies, regulations and rules, really quick, processes, critical timelines, pitfalls to avoid, extensions to 1031s. I'm not going to cover that, but Florida gets a lot of them because you have hurricanes and all those things. Those hurricanes provide extensions to your timelines that I'm going to talk about. Many people don't know that. And you need to understand when you can qualify for that extension. I'm going to cover that real briefly. But I'm going to talk about reverse and improvement exchanges. I'm not going to talk about Delaware statutory trust today because I'm going to spend my time talking about partnership issues and seller financing and what clients are doing today that might give you an opportunity to buy a property that otherwise might not have been available for sale. Is that fair? I will give you a quick story about that statement. Sometimes the opportunity that presents itself for an investor or a buyer of a property, even a seller of a property, is the fact that a property came to market and sold. For example, in the pandemic, my son and my daughter both were looking for a property to purchase. And they thought, I told them, I said, it's a good time because an opportunity could very well present itself during the pandemic. We all agree that was a big mess, wasn't it? But we didn't know what the opportunity was going to look like. Our kids look for those things, not understanding what the opportunity was, just knowing that there was an opportunity. And I think if you ever ask Nissan if there's an opportunity, there's one every day. You just don't know what it is yet. So always be looking. This was the opportunity that came to them. They were able to locate an amazing townhome located in Old Town Scottsdale that would have never, ever came to market had it not been for the pandemic. They did not get a good deal on it, but they got a property that would have never come to market, ever. Why? Because it was a cash flowing cow when it's rented, and it was not being rented because of the pandemic. The guy was panicking. He had 17 Airbnbs and none of them were filled. He needed to unload. Okay, we'll take one. So we actually would not want to take two. But to understand the opportunities, on my phone calls to clients that call me to talk about 1031 exchanges, I hear what's going on in the marketplace. I don't need to read the newspaper. I don't need to hear from other people. My clients are asking me questions. For example, back in 2014, I started getting a lot of phone calls on mobile home parks. Crazy, weird. Mobile home this, mobile home that. Mobile home parks, I love them. I said, what's going on with these things? And what happened in 2018, 19, and 20? That thing cranked up. They always lead about a year and a half into it. When all the Starbucks's and all the pop-up coffee shops, all the Black Rocks, all the little, you know, standalone shops for coffee shops, I started getting phone calls for 1031 exchanges for postage stamp size real estate on shopping center lots. Go figure. What do they want that for? Guess what happened? Charging Tesla cars, electric charging stations, that same postage stamp started popping up everywhere about 4 years ago, 5 years ago, before Tesla even came around. Kind of crazy, huh? Well, today what's happening, our clients are calling me with this in mind. What I'm about to share with you is current and real, and it's going to be going on for the next 15 years. Okay, so I'm hoping you kind of get a little grip. So why are we going to do a 1031 exchange? Well, the first one is, of course, to defer capital gains taxes. We don't want to pay them if we don't have to. I pay my taxes, but if I otherwise can defer them, I'm going to. And if I can eliminate them, I'm always going to do that too. But if I have to pay them, it's like an anchor on my boat. Every time I sell something, I got to pay more than I made in it sometimes in taxes. It's crazy. But that's the number one motivator for someone wanting to do a 1031. But guess what? It's also the number one reason why a lot of people do not sell their real estate. They do not know they can defer the taxes or convert this asset or otherwise use the money in other ways that better suits them than today. They say, if I don't sell, I don't have to pay the taxes. They know if they die, which they will, that the kids get it all stepped up in basis with no taxes associated with it at all. So why sell? Well, there's a lot of reasons to sell. A lot of times it's time to sell. One of the biggest things I don't like today is that so many properties have a 3% loan on them. And that's keeping people from selling their property, isn't it? But that very same property is not cash flowing only because it has a 3% loan. They're not making any money on it, but they're not losing anything because they're only paying 3%. It's the wrong property. It's costing them more money to maintain it. It's costing them more money to keep a bad tenant. They don't know what they're doing. They can't raise their rents. They don't know how to deal with this, but they're not going to sell because of either the 3% mortgage or because of the taxes. Well, the taxes I can take care of as a 1031 exchange, obviously. Obviously, we can build wealth if we do a 1031 exchange by using the money that normally is lost to the IRS. You use that to buy more real estate. What better way to get wealthy? Tax-deferred compound growth, I call it. And if anybody argues with me, I ask them if they like IRAs or 401ks, and they say they do. And I say, do you fund that first at work, or do you fund your taxable account first? And they always tell me they fund their tax-deferred accounts first. Why? Because their CPA said it's a great idea. Well, a 1031 exchange is tax-deferred compound growth on your real estate holdings that are held for investment. What crazy great thing is that? When I learned that tool in 1997, my whole life spun in a different direction, and I'm so glad I learned about this. We want to improve their income. Remember, a lot of times they're holding on to older properties that you would like to buy because you have the ability, the teams, the ways, and the means to repair those properties at efficient costs, and you know what you're doing. A lot of people don't know what they're doing. They're holding on to dilapidated properties that are costing them more money than they possibly could make. So the improvement of income is a big one if they could do a 1031. Improve the asset quality, obviously. They would like to go from what they have to something that's not going to be maintenance. And who am I talking about? If I'm saying all these things, more than likely the person we're talking to is more than 55 years old. They've owned the properties probably 20 years. They've owned them for a long time. They've just kind of gotten in the groove with it, but they haven't really kept it up and they don't really understand. But believe it or not, they're 65 and 70 right now are the big targets. They're saying, you know something, I've done well for myself. It's time to let go. I wouldn't mind throttling back. I wouldn't mind doing some of these things I knew. How can I use my money, my assets better? Because everybody on this call is a real estate investor. If you've been in it a while, you know that you're really wealthy, but you're broke. You have no cash. It's all tied up in your real estate. But if you're just getting started, you don't have the wealth yet and you need to create it. Well, my job here is to say that this 1031 exchange, if you're younger or younger in the business, it's okay to be doing flips. I still do flips. I love flips if I see a good deal. But guess what? My buy, fix, hold, and sell are my big winners. I hold it for a few years. I never pay taxes. I rally this stuff together through 1031 exchange. And all of a sudden, I get a little older and number five shows up. I need a change of lifestyle, guys. I'm done. I'm really kind of tired. I'm not going to admit it because I've done well. I have lots of properties. But this is the number one reason people will talk to me about a 1031 exchange when I'm talking to them on the phone. I don't call investors. I talk to them. People refer them to me because someone told them that they could sell a property and not pay any taxes. And when they call me, I ask them a simple question. Listen, I know you want to go do this, but what is it you really want to see the money do? And you'd be shocked to know how many times they tell me they don't want to be managing anymore. And when they find out they don't have to and they can go different directions and do different stuff with the money, they leave, and they don't leave small, they leave large. I had one guy sell 19 properties of his 27 properties 2 years ago because he found out about this little tool. You mean to tell me I can take my 19 properties and sell them and buy stuff all over the country for my kids to live in and rent, and I could buy vacation properties that I might want to use and my future retirement home? I can do that with a 1031? Absolutely. You mean to tell me I can buy a Delaware statutory trust and just walk away from management altogether if I sell these things? Yes, you can. Do you mean to tell me I can do a seller carry financing on this deal and still do a 1031 exchange? You mean to tell me I can carry the financing on this property and earn the income that I normally would have lost if I sold it for however long I want to? And when that note's paid off, I don't have to pay the taxes if I structure it correctly? Absolutely. How does that work? Through a 1031 exchange. So I'm going to let's get into it real quick and we'll go through it. So here's the taxes that we're dealing with. There's lots of them. At the federal level, it's based between 15 and 20% of the gain. What you made for it, plus improvements, is going to be the capital gains, what you sold it for. The next one is going to be the state. They want their cut. And each state's a little bit different. California's the highest at 13.3. They're really motivated. And Washington and Florida are among the lowest at zero. I say among the lowest because when it's zero, states have what's called a transfer tax to replace the capital gains tax. Some states are rather abusive, Washington being one of them. California is bringing one in, but it's very small. But once they introduce it as small, guess what happens to it over time? It gets big. The excise and transfer taxes, guys, I can't defer those. But all the other stuff I can, and there's more. We have a federal depreciation recapture tax at 25%. So that's what you depreciated the property. And by the way, if you don't depreciate the properties, they're still going to impute this tax upon you. So please depreciate your properties. And the last one's the federal net investment income tax at 3.8. God, Doug, we please stop with the taxes. So the average tax that people ask me all the time, well, what's the tax bill going to look like if I sell my property? Yeah, I haven't got a clue. I really don't. All these taxes involved, I simply say, if it's that much of a concern to you, check with your accountant. It's a blended rate between 20 and 40%, depending on what state and how long you own the property. But if you do a 1031 exchange and structure it right, this shouldn't be an issue. We'll take care of this. And they really like to hear that. And I don't go into detail about all these different taxes. I don't need to do that. But this is the number one reason why people do 1031s and the number one reason why people will not sell a property. So, and unfortunately, guess what? Every day I get a phone call. I just found out about this cool tool called a 1031 exchange. Oh my God, what a great loophole, they tell me. And I correct them very quickly. I am not a loophole. I am a federal law. And I love to be able to say that to people because I'm not a loophole. I'm not a scam. I'm the deal. So I'm cheap too, by the way. My fees are about $1,100 to do an average exchange. It'll go up to as high as $4,500 for a standard exchange. And reverse and improvement exchanges go to roughly about $8,000, depending on what we're doing. But there's a reason for that. And I think I'll explain a little bit to you later. So I'm not going to go over the different reasons here on a couple of them on the asset quality. And believe that alone, I'll just send this to you. But the change of lifestyle is a really big one. This is your reason why people are selling. And this is the reason you may want to sell some of your properties to position yourself for the future. This doesn't have to be the person you're buying from. This could be you. I mean, maybe you have a couple of properties. You're saying, you know something, I'm 60, 65, I'm 55. I'm getting ready to retire. I don't really want to retire maybe in Florida. Maybe you want to retire in another state. Maybe you want to retire in another town. Maybe you just want to retire in a Mac Daddy home that you love. But if you wait to buy that home 5 years from now when you retire, you may not be able to afford it. So in the middle of selling one of your properties, you got massive capital gains in. Why not use that money to buy that property today, rent it out to somebody for a few years, and when you're ready to retire, you can move into it. Secured. Rehab it when that happens, and you got a beautiful home. So again, it's a topic I love talking about because it's a number one thing. It's buying a future retirement home. I got one person right now sold an $8.2 million property because guess why? They were told they could do a 1031 exchange and buy a vacation property in California on the beach for $4.5 million. That's been their dream for life, to own a vacation property on the beach in La Jolla. Is that crazy? They sold an $8 million asset to fulfill a dream because they found out they could. Nothing more than that. That's a change of lifestyle, guys. Now, they can't use it for 2 years, but after 2 years, they could do what they want with it. But that's huge. It's a reason for them to sell. Maybe you want to own something like that yourself. What a great reason to keep the IRS's money sheltered through a 1031. Use that money later on to buy your future vacation or your dream home. Well, you know, maybe it's just a vacation home. Maybe it's the Delaware Statutory Trust. Maybe it's a triple net lease. Maybe it's another asset you can back off of the management and enjoy freaking life. All of us on the call that have been in business for a while, even at Sign Will Save once in a while, that real estate can be really hectic. It could drive you freaking crazy. And I can promise you, he even takes a vacation every year to get away from it. But at some point, you want to back off and throttle down. So at that point is when we come into play. So 1031 exchange, really, it's only going to be about selling a property you held for investment for a couple of years when you sold it. And you're going to buy a property with this 1031 exchange that's also going to be an investment piece of real estate. It's called like-kind property. It's really confusing that way. But like-kind simply means it's investment real property for investment real property, which is a huge, broad stroke of the paintbrush on what you can do with this. It's not a duplex for a duplex. It's not a shopping center for a shopping center. You can go from commercial to residential. You can go from residential to commercial. You can sell one and buy 10. You can sell 10 and buy one. As long as you can structure it correctly, we can do some amazing things with this product. So the way we do the 1031s is called a deferred, is the most common, where we sell one and then buy one. Really simple, we go and do it. Simultaneous means we had to buy and sell the properties the same day with the same escrow officer, please. We don't like these, but we can do them if you have to. The reverse exchange is really a powerful tool for those that need to close on a property before they've been able to sell the one that they want to use for the exchange. We will buy it for you using your cash and give you the balance of your exchange period to sell your property. Huge profit, huge potential for this one. For example, in the pandemic, were prices going down extraordinarily fast or going up extraordinarily fast? They were going up, weren't they? It was crazy. We had people saying, I could sell my property in 30 seconds. Can I go buy one first and then sell mine later? And they said, yes. So we buy it using their cash. And guess what? They now own two properties for 6 months that pretty much both doubled in value in some cases. And they completed their exchanges with more money than they thought they knew what to do. It was crazy what happened. So each market presents something different. And it also could go the opposite direction. If real estate's going down and you own two, it's twice as painful, right? So we got to be careful when we do this. But the reverse exchange is designed, you have to buy something before you sold. And it's happening a lot today because honestly, the inventory is so low, okay? But you know you can sell your property, but you need time to find the right property. That's where reverse comes into play for you. A lease to improve exchange. I don't want to talk too much about this. We're not going to get into it. But an improvement exchange or a build to suit is what I want to mention. If you sell for $500,000 and you're only buying for $400,000, for example, you're going to get taxed on $100,000 that you didn't reinvest. But you tell me that the property you bought needs to be improved. It has a bunch of stuff wrong with it, which most do. Can I use that $100,000 to fix that property up? And the answer is yes. We call it an improvement exchange. We'll give you the balance of 180 calendar days. Whenever you did it, we'll use the cash to improve that property. It's pretty slick. They are expensive. The reverse and the improvement cost about $7,500 because we're taking title to the property. I got an attorney. I got to pay for it. That's what makes it expensive. And we don't really make a lot of money on them. They're really more fee related to us. So they are a little more expensive. I'm not going to talk about non-safe harbor because it's not something you guys would be participating in, I hope. It's for my 50 million plus. I'd like to see you participate in them, but I've done three of them in my 22 years in business. So I just mentioned we can do them. A 1031 exchange is not for fix and flips. If your intention when you bought the property is just to resell it, the IRS will not allow the 1031. This typically happens within a very short period of time. The other one is going to be a property that's held for resale. If you bought a property as a developer, for example, you're building, you bought a lot, subdivided into 16 lots, and you're building the houses and reselling them, you're in business of selling, you know, of building homes. You're not in the business of being an investor. You're called a dealer. So if you're doing this, if you're buying property and you got a lot of it and you're a developer, I ask you to separate the properties you're holding for investment in a separate entity away from your development business. That segregates it from you and your dealer activity so the IRS cannot worry about these other properties that you are holding for investment. Just trying to tickle your feather or you know stroke the subconscious to know, just give us a call if you got questions how it may reflect to you, okay? Rules for a successful exchange, I'm gonna go really fast through this. It's intent plus time. So at the time of the sale, the property you're selling was held for a period of time. We like to hear 2 years, okay? And your intent is you're going to buy a new property for investment. You're going to also hold for about 2 years. But I get the question, Doug, do I have to wait 2 years? And the answer is no, you do not. Well, Doug, how long do I have to wait? Well, here's how it really truly works. If it's 2 years or longer, the reason we say that, the IRS gives you what's called safe harbor of the reason why you did a 1031. Because you may have heard about 1031 exchange being referred to as a safe harbor exchange. That's what they're talking about. It's they're going to leave you alone. They're not going to question what your intent was when you did it. If you hold it less than 2 years, they can question you. So that comes to be that, well, when should I do it? I want the property to be on two tax returns is what the IRS really wants. The property you did it, when you bought it, the IRS knew nothing about it, did they? They won't find out about it till next April when you do your taxes. They still don't know what you did with it. They got to wait another year to see what you did with it. So that means two tax returns. So I tell people a year and a day is the minimum I like to hear you hold a property that's eligible for a 1031 exchange. Well, Doug, I only owned it for 6 months. Can I do a 1031 exchange? Now, on Facebook, I do not want you repeating this. Because this is really a touchy topic. We can do a 1031 exchange if you held the property less than a year, but we definitely want to talk to your tax advisor or your legal team to make sure you're okay and that the IRS probably won't come back and try to audit you for the transaction. We want to make sure we can't be the police. We're not going to tell you we won't do the exchange, but we really, truly would love to see it. Well, to do it correctly. Let me give you an example of when it might be okay. And I had one happen that that we held the property less than 6 months. The client had bought a property through a 1031 exchange in November of 2019. In February of 2020, he calls me up again and says, Doug, I have another one. I'm ready to do the exchange. I type the address into my system and the red flag pops up, says, hey, no, no, no. We just bought this one 3 months ago with the 1031. It doesn't qualify. So I said, I'm sorry. I don't think it's going to work. He goes, that's funny. My CPA said it'll be okay. Well, I said, well, then I want to talk to your CPA. And the CPA came back and said, you know something? This client, I've done over 30 exchanges for him over his 50-year career in real estate. And he's held properties one of three ways. One, two ways. It either doubled in value or 10 years went by. That's when every single solitary one of them. I said, okay, so what makes this one so special? He bought it in November and he just sold it for three times what he paid for it to a developer who wanted to buy his piece of land. I said, did he know the developer? Nope. Was it pre-assumed that he was going to do this because he bought it? Nope. The guy came out of nowhere. I want him to do the exchange. Yeah, that's his MO. He doubled. I'm more than happy to defend this if should the IRS call. He is an investor. And he's going to buy another property through the 1031 exchange. He's probably going to hold 3 to 5 years anyway. So guess what? The CPAs gave the thumbs up. I'm doing the exchange. But then I had to ask him. I get the doubling of value. I said, what's the 10-year number? He goes, well, if it didn't double in 10 years, it's a pig and he's going to sell it. So that was the reason why it did him after 10 years. So that's intent plus time. So the same taxpayer that sells must be the taxpayer that buys. When I get to the partnership issues in a few moments and those types of things, this is what I'm talking about. The same taxpayer, if it's a partnership that sells the property, the partnership has to be what buys the replacement property. That could be problematic if you guys want to go your separate ways. There are solutions to this. And I'm going to explain that later on in this topic. You must buy like-kind property, so it's going to be investment real estate. No big deal. And the seller should purchase equal or greater value than what they sell. Now, notice I said should purchase equal or greater value. You don't have to purchase equal or greater value. If you buy less than what you sold, you will have what's called boot. And that's perfectly fine. You just understand there's tax associated with that boot. And if you know the tax is there, it's never a problem. But what has to understand also, you might have write-offs on your tax returns that offset those taxes. For example, immediate expensing is a huge tool. For every dollar you put into your property that's personal property for business use, you can currently write off 60% of that value the year you buy it as a loss. And if you're using the boot from the exchange to do that, well, you just saved a bunch in taxes. That's scheduled to potentially go back to 100% by the end of this year. We'll have to wait and see if that comes to fruition. That would mean that every dollar you put in, you get a dollar write-off. Kind of nice. The seller should buy, reinvest all the cash proceeds from the sales, how it works. And you should obtain equal or greater debt or bring new cash to pay off any debt relieved when you sold the property. So when a client asks you, how much should I really buy with this 1031 exchange? I have a really simple mathematical calculation. It doesn't take wizardry to figure out. You simply take the cash proceeds at the end of the day that came to the 1031 company after the close and add back in any debt that you paid off, and you'll have a great number to shoot for your 1031 exchange. Anything that's received by the client that's not real property is considered boot and is going to be subject to tax. I'm going to talk about seller financing in a minute. If you carry a note away from the transaction as a seller financing, is that note real property? The answer is absolutely not. So it will be considered boot. But when are you taxed on that note? You're taxed on that financing when you get a principal payment on that note. The interest will always be taxable, no foul. But the principal payments as you receive them are also taxed. And when the note is paid off, all of the taxes that were associated with it still in it are due. And the worst part about it is a note or a contract sale does not receive a gratuitous step up in basis upon the death of the owner, as real estate will. So if I bought a piece of real estate for $100,000 20 years ago, and I should happen to pass away next week and it's worth $1 million, my basis on that property when I die to my family is $1 million, not $100,000. That means that all that money now went to my estate at that value, And I believe the value is $12.7 million to the federal government that I can die with no estate tax if my estate is set up correctly. So we call it swapping till you drop, because the only thing I can guarantee, well, actually you hear two things in life are guaranteed, death and taxes. But I say the taxes part I can fix. So I only guarantee death, is that that's okay. So at the end of the day, I want to use my benefit, not my demise. Partial exchanges are allowed. Non-reoccurring expenses and closing costs can be paid for with a 1031 exchange. You as a wholesaler, you as an agent, you as attorney or a CPA can charge your fee to the seller of a client doing a 1031 exchange and be paid with those proceeds without the seller having to pay tax on that. And I would think they would want to do that, because typically that's going to be an expense of the sale that's going to offset any taxes that would have been due. So remember, as a wholesaler, you're going to charge $10,000-$20,000 to a seller. If they want to do a 1031, bill the account at closing and get paid at closing. Guess what? It's an eligible closing cost. They don't need to write you a check. But if you can get the cash up front, obviously it's better. But if they don't want to pay tax on it, that's good. Refinancing before and after an exchange. I want to make clear on this also, because on the internet you read that you can't do this. Do not refinance before or after an exchange the same year. That's hogwash. You can refinance. You just can't cash out refinance. The same year of the exchange, if you've cashed out and put money in your bank account and not reinvesting that money, that is considered boot to the IRS. If they find it, they will recharacterize the loan as a taxable event, because you knew you were doing a 1031. You're doing the loan now to avoid paying taxes. They'll recharacterize it and charge the tax. However, if you took the loan out and you use the money to reinvest and buy more property or fix up one of your properties, it's completely allowed. It's a business expense. It's a reason for the loan, not to avoid the IRS. And after you buy a property, my gosh, you can always refinance that property if you put the money back into the property or into other assets that you own. It happens a lot. So again, talk to your CPA before you do it, just to make sure, and just make sure your bases are covered so that everybody knows what's going on. Because your CPA is the one that's going to report everything for you, and they may want specific information to make sure that the IRS does call them or send them a letter that they have some information to work with to tell them it's okay. So the closing costs are eligible, closing costs that are not eligible. I just want to talk about real quickly that like-kind properties are all kinds, and Delaware statutory trusts do qualify, as well as vacation homes. Oftentimes, second homes do, Airbnbs, all kinds of assets qualify, triple net leases. As long as it's investment real estate, we're good to go. Opportunity zones are not eligible. If you're talking to someone about doing an opportunity zone project, it has a whole different set of laws and rules. I'm very much in tune with them, and I do advise on them, but they're not 1031 exchange eligible. To wrap it up, before I get into my two topics, I want to talk about the timelines. We need to be involved when you're selling a piece of real estate as soon as you get an accepted offer and you open up escrow. We cannot be involved after you close. Once you receive the proceeds and you touch the money, we cannot do a 1031. It's always best to call me before you list the property for sale anyway to talk about it and be prepared. Because as soon as you get this thing closed, some really nasty timelines kick in. The day of the closing is day zero. You'll have 45 calendar days to identify to me what property or properties you'd like to own or purchase with this 1031. You don't have to have offers on them. You don't have to buy them. But there's this finite number of properties you can put on a list to me that after the 45th day will become the only properties eligible for purchase with the 1031 after the 45th day. And that list cannot change. You can do anything you want before the 45th day, but after the 45th day is when it gets really nasty. Whatever you put on that list, you'll have the balance of 180 calendar days to close up and purchase, spend as much money as you can, and replace as much debt as you can. So on that list of properties, there's a couple of things you can do. The extensions I talked about earlier, and I'm sharing it with you in Florida because you get so many of these extensions. An act of Congress on a declared natural disaster will give an extension to many of these properties, a lot of them. And what that means is the 180 day and the 45 days can get extensions of an additional 120 days. That's a very generous offer. But realize this, most people do not realize that the fact is to qualify for this extension doesn't mean that your property was located where the hurricane was. Listen to me carefully. Your property may have been where the hurricane was, sure. But what if you lived where the hurricane was, you were affected, you as a person cannot operate or function, and you're selling a property in Wyoming? Guess what? You can't function. You get the extension. Okay? Your business could have been located where the disaster was, and your real estate could have been somewhere else. Just remember, if you have a hurricane or a disaster and you think you need an extension, always call your qualified intermediary to see if you qualify for anything that may come up, because we're in that season right now to do that. Now, to identify, there's three ways: three property rule, 200% rule, and the 95% exception. Just remember this, not to worry too much about this. I don't like people going out looking for three properties because you have to identify three. You can identify just one that you're working on. But if you get out there to where you need to identify a list of properties as backups, that's where this list comes into play. If you're selling one property for, let's say, $500,000, let's say a million, and you're only going to buy one property worth about $1 million, I would keep your list to three properties or less, because it could be of any value, but only three properties. If you need to identify more than three, then you're going to be capped at 200% of what you sold. So that would mean that I would tell you, if you sold something, say, for $2 million, it's all cash, and you wanted to buy, say, four duplexes for $500,000 each, obviously, you're going to identify more than three, aren't you? You got to buy, identify four because you're buying four. That's okay, as long as you don't identify more than 200% of what you sold. That rule comes into play when you're buying a bunch of smaller valued assets. Again, I don't want to get into the gory details about this, but we go over this when you open up an exchange with me. And I go through all the details as it relates to what you're doing, because I could talk for 6 hours about this topic, and I could haze every client that comes in and calls me, but it's not worth it. I spend about 15 or 20 minutes with them. We go through the rules with how it applies to them and what they're doing. And we take a phone call every now and again as things tweak and massage through the process. My consultations are complimentary always. We're setting that up. Lastly, a lot of people like to wait till last minute to set the exchange up right before the close, because they're afraid the buyer might back away and they don't want to pay my fee if the buyer backs away. Well, not to fear that, we don't charge a fee if the property doesn't close. That allows our clients to just go ahead and open it as soon as they can. If the buyer backs away, no harm, no foul. We don't like rushing around last minute with this topic. We like to make sure we have time to read things, but I can open up an exchange 15 minutes before the close. I don't like doing it, but I can do it. I can't open one 15 minutes after the close. Okay, so keep that in mind. I'm going to go and wrap this up and kind of finish up with some other things in here for you. My contact information. I'm going to take the presentation off now and kind of go back over, start talking about some other things. But do we have any questions you want to cover at this point before I get into the two specialty topics?
I have a question.
Yes.
You mentioned that we can buy a property before we sell our property. Can you dive more into that?
Yes, it's called a reverse exchange. The reverse exchange means that you have to acquire a property as part of a 1031, but your property has not sold yet. So what happens is we need, if it's a commercial property, we can use regular financing to purchase it and your cash. Okay, because a commercial loan, the loan's based upon the commercial property performance, not you. So they're great for commercial assets. For residential assets, we can still do them. But on a residential loan, fourplexes or less, the loans are based upon the borrower's ability to pay, not the building. And we're going to be on title. We're not going to get a loan. Your buyer's not on title. They're not going to give a loan to them because they got to be on title. So they need a lot of cash on residential. They can borrow from other places. They can do hard money. They can use an IRA loan. They can do all kinds of neat stuff to buy it, but they need cash to make the reverse. What happens is we'll take that cash and we will acquire the property as the owner, as an EAT, exchange accommodating title holder, and we'll hold that property up to 180 calendar days, allowing you time to sell one of your properties. You'll still need to identify what you're selling with us by the 45th day, but at the end of the day, when it does finally sell, what ends up happening? We take the proceeds from that sale and roll them forward. On a residential loan, they're now going on title, so you can get traditional financing to get the thing done. We then give any leftover cash back to the exchanger as just a return of earnest money, basically what we've done. On commercial properties, it's a little bit different. because we can get a commercial loan, and it's a loan that's in place well before and after the exchange. We don't need to refinance anything. We simply roll cash forward, and we need to be able to talk to that lender to make sure they understand that loan is going to be transferred. We're going to be on title in the beginning. When it transfers title to the exchanger, they can't call the loan due just because it transferred title. And the terms have to remain the same. There can't be any additional expenses. It's just a mere fact that we're on title as an accommodator. We only have the title is what makes it work. We do not have any other right to the property. The investor still owns all of the other property rights. They can destroy it if they want. We simply hold title. That's how a reverse works. They're really powerful, and we do a lot of them for that very reason. They're expensive in comparison, but if you look at the numbers, they're not what it allows you to do. So if you have a specific case on reverse, give me a call. I'll be more than happy to talk to you.
Okay. On a reverse residential, I would have to come up with the money to buy the house, and then the 1031 money would be transferred over, correct? On a residential.
Correct. You can also have the seller carry the financing for the period.
Right.
Okay. You can have them do a short-term loan for 1 year, and when you get done, just buy them out. Gotcha. If they're willing to do that. Many of them aren't, but many of them will.
Okay. And you mentioned something about a DST. Can you elaborate what is a DST?
So I'm going to be talking about that as part of one of those tools that a lot of your clients, your sellers do not know exists. It is not an exciting product. It is not about getting rich. It's about preservation of wealth and income and the ability not to pay taxes and to transfer an asset to your family tax-free upon your demise. So typically it's going to be a little bit older of a client that's owned a property for a while. They don't want to be a landlord anymore, or maybe their health doesn't allow it. Maybe they don't have a family member they can pass it to right away. They're afraid that mom, or maybe nowadays the other spouse, can't manage the property should something happen to them. They got to throttle back, but they need income and they don't want to pay taxes. A Delaware statutory trust is a fractional ownership in a very large commercial asset, and you are a piece of it. For example, a typical DST would be a multifamily house, a multifamily apartment complex, typically ranging between $75 and $150 million. They're very large assets, and they're very well stabilized. They're not B properties, they're A properties. They've got solid management in place, and they're very much stabilized. They're not about making money, they're about preserving money. They're expensive because they got expenses in place on them. So your typical yield on a DST would be right now, the market's between 4.75 and 6% on your cash. But the beautiful thing is it's on all of your cash, not after tax cash. So if you do the equivalent before tax yield, it's like almost 7.5 to 8% is what you're getting as a yield. And you still get depreciation and you get growth. And guess what? You can also increase your depreciation schedules because you can take on what's called non-recourse debt in a DST. It's something that a lot of your clients that get older, they've fully depreciated their properties. That means that all the income they're receiving is getting taxed at a very heavy rate. There's no depreciation to offset the income anymore, but they're too old and don't want to take on debt because it shows up on them. Well, I tell them, ask your CPA how much depreciation you need and let's go get some. And I say, what? Really simple. Let's say the CPA says you need to have $30,000 a year in depreciation. Great. Give me $400,000 cash. We'll go buy a DST that has 50% leverage, non-recourse, and we'll buy an asset that's going to give you $400,000 more depreciation to take on for the rest of your life over the next 27 and a half years. It's all these little nuances really kill and help the bottom line of these investors. And when they start seeing the effects of the bottom line, not just the asset return, but the fact that all their income, not just the DST, is now super tax efficient versus tax heavy, they say, okay, I'll sell one. I can sell two. How many can I sell? So anyway, you can also do a 1031 exchange and buy a building for a family member for their business, as long as they rent it back. Most of my clients want to help their kids. Yes.
Last question. And then I see Dan has his hand up. Let's say I'm selling a property for $300,000. I have a $100,000 mortgage on it. So I'm getting $200,000 at closing. I have to buy a property minimum $300,000 or greater. Have to put all of that $200,000 that I received from the sale into the property?
or can I put $100,000 and get financing? Or I'm saying, let's say I find a $400,000 home or a duplex or something like that. Can I put just $100,000 into that duplex or four unit property? Or do I have to put all of the cash, the 200, into the property?
On the internet, it says you must put all the cash. But in reality, I always ask, what are you going to do with the money you keep? See, that's where the key is. Let's go over two examples, because this is a very powerful tool. A lot of my clients do a 1031 exchange, and they realize they got to reinvest all the cash and replace the debt. But if they take any cash, it's taxable, right? But they need money to fix up the property they're buying. Right. They need money. So they keep 50 grand. Well, they need more than that. So what if they created a bigger loan? In your case, you had a $100,000 loan. What if you took a $200,000 loan, okay, on the new property? That will leave you in that exchange account $200,000 in cash, right? Uh-huh. But if you're using that $200,000 in cash to improve real estate, like air conditioners and rehab and tenant improvements, all those things, you got to talk to your accountant to see of that those assets you're buying with that money, can you get a write-off up front, or is it going to get amortized over time? Section 179 for commercial properties is huge, because tenant improvements, ACs, roofs, a lot of things count for immediate expensing, still up to $1 million. So it just depends what you're going to do with the money. You can take the money, but it's going to be subject to tax. If you have an offsetting tax loss or a way to create one before that year end, yes, I would recommend doing it. So again, it's a maybe. Okay. Did that help?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Okay, good.
I mean, so yes, I'm in the process of selling a property, so I'm going to have to reach out to you to figure out what's the best
way. Yeah, and we'll go offline with it, and just we'll nail it. Because again, on Facebook, if you're listening to me on Facebook, there's no way to know what's going on, and I can't guarantee success. And my job is not to mess up the IRS. That's not what I'm doing. I'm simply trying to share what the rules are out there to help you reinvest some money appropriately, because the IRS loves when you do 1031s, and the reason they do is that if you're taking the money and spending it on investment properties, you're not only keeping people employed, you're paying money to people that they can tax as income. They make a lot more money on income tax than they do capital gains tax. And if you buy a bigger property and fix it up, you're going to charge more rent, aren't you? They're going to get more taxable income from you. Guys, they win too. But if you take the money and they can't win, that's when they get upset. I mean, that's reality. It's if you take the money and put it in a place where they can't tax you, just to avoid paying tax, not to be an investor or help anybody else, that's when it starts to look kind of weird, okay? And that's when you start looking for an audit, okay? Okay, I'm going to jump into a couple quick topics here if I can. Do I have enough time?
I know Dan had a question.
I would say, Rick, a question, Doug. Hey, thanks. That was a wonderful thing. But real quick, what is the best approach to go from a family that inherited a commercial property, selling it, splitting the proceeds? What if one of the family members wants to reinvest their earnings, their capital gains, and what is the best approach on that? Is that feasible? Is that possible to go ahead and one of the family members reinvesting their own portion of it?
Correct. So in your case, a family inherited a property, okay? Three or four siblings own it. I have to ask the question, how long ago did the person die that left the gift, that left the donate, the
last property? Year?
Last year?
Yes.
Okay. So remember, throughout this presentation, I talked about what's something called a step up in basis. It happens upon death. Depending on the state you're living in, the effect of that step up. For example, California, Arizona, Washington State, and eight other states are community property states. Basically saying that they're, you know, each spouse passing, they get a step up in that basis. So let's say it's worth $1 million when dad died. In a community property state, when the first spouse dies, the second spouse can sell tax-free because it stepped up in basis. But in other states like Florida, the second spouse finally dies, there's going to be some taxes due because the first spouse passed away earlier and the property still grew in value. But the beautiful thing is that the estate had to be settled upon that second death, didn't it? All of the taxes that had to be paid were paid and they're done. So the basis is at the time of that second person's death, That's what it is. If they've only owned it 1 year, there's probably not much capital gains tax in it. It's only been 1 year. They want to check with their accountant to see if they even need to do something with it. But now, let's say, for example, it did. Let's say zoning changed or something cool happened and made this $1 million property worth $3 million. Well, yeah, now we need to do a 1031 exchange. Or maybe they owned it 10 years after dad died and it grew more. They can each separate from that trust before the trust is done as individuals, tenants in common, as owners. By doing that, the trust no longer owns the asset, the individuals do. And if they do that far enough in advance, at least a year or two in advance of their sale, they can easily do a 1031. However, if they don't have the luxury of that, and they're just finding out now that they can do something, I just ask them to talk to their tax and legal advisors to see if they can restructure that trust or their distribution from that trust as a non-taxable event.
Okay.
Okay, then they can do a 1031 if they have to. Okay. It's very much about like the partnership issues I'm about to cover. So that's a great question, Dan. Thanks for asking. Okay.
You're welcome.
So let's get over here to this next little thing. I'll wrap up pretty quick. I didn't mean to go this long, but I get a little long winded. So is that okay?
No, it's like very informative.
Okay, the next one's going to be this. This is really, really big, guys. Seller financing and selling on contract is skyrocketing. Why? Because I'm an investor. I'm sitting here going, our client has to pay 7.5% interest on a property. I can earn that 7.5%. In fact, I could take 8 because I'm not going to charge them closing costs, and I could charge them 9 because they don't qualify for a loan. Let's go. Okay. So I now selling a property, I'm losing the income stream. I could turn around and replace it by carrying the financing, and the CPA tells me, great idea. I can spread this tax bill that from this 1031 or the sale of this property over the length of that loan. Okay. Let's say I take a 10-year loan.
Are you done sharing your screen?
What's that?
Are you done sharing?
Oh, no, I didn't stop. Can you see it?
Yes, yes.
It says tips, tricks, and pitfalls?
No.
It doesn't? Oh,
no.
Okay, hold on a second. Let me figure it out. Oh, I know what I did. Hold on a second. Hold on a second. Come on. One second here. Oh, it's paused for some reason. One second. One second.
Mm-hmm.
Now just I paused it somehow. Oh, ask ad name. Oh no, that's not it. How did I pause it? It's weird. Second.
Maybe just to close it and then we can start over again.
Okay, I'll come back in.
Yeah.
Stop share.
There you go.
Right. Now I want to share. Where is it? There it is. There we go. Can you see that?
There we go.
Yep. All right, cool. All right. So the seller financing, seller on contract is huge. And so my example was I can charge my buyer 9%, for example, and I can make some good money and I'll charge them that for 5 years. My CPA says it's a good idea because I can spread this tax liability as I get these principal payments over 5 years and manage this tax bill. That's really wonderful. But the problem with it is if it's 9%, the second that buyer can refinance, what are they going to do? They're going to refinance it. They're going to get rid of this guy. Now all those taxes are due at that point. So many of your sellers will sell on contract anyway because they don't understand that. That's a beautiful thing. Because if they don't understand it, they talk to their CPA and their CPA is going to tell them it's a great idea. So you're coming in buying the property from them. Your hit to them is, I'm going to pay a rent to you. I'm going to pay you a mortgage payment, basically. You're going to keep the same income you had as a renter, but I'm going to own the property. And you, if I don't make the payment, you can foreclose on me. How about that? It's secured by the property. They like that idea. But wait a minute. I have a question. There is a possibility that I might refinance this property again, get rid of you quickly. So then how do I avoid the fact that taxes might be due? And how we do that is, let's use Nissan's example. I sell for $300,000 and I come in and I accept from the buyer $50,000 down payment and I carry $250,000 on contract. Okay. The $50,000 is taxable the year received. The interest is taxable as I receive it. And the principal payments are taxed as I receive it. The income I'm getting is almost all taxed. It's not really pretty, but it's attractive because I'm getting a great rate. And they're happy with that. So what if I can get rid of that tax bill on the principal? And this is what most people don't know. And when they figure it out, they love seller financing. This is how it works. I'll take the $50,000 down payment, but instead of taking it personally, I'll send it to the exchange at the close. And I'm going to take $250,000 of my own cash, and I'm going to give it to the title company to include with the $50,000 that goes to the title company. Okay. Now, what we just did effectively is we just bought our own note with cash. We're going to complete a full exchange today for $300,000 and replace the income that I lost by selling the property. I'm going to buy a new property with it. I could buy a DST. A lot of them go to DSTs because they're selling it because they don't want to manage the property anymore. But this, guess what? Now that note that they hold, when it gets paid off, there is no tax due on principal payments. The basis on that note is now $250,000, not a taxable equivalent. So it's a really powerful situation that if a client understands they can do, can really do the bottom line. Because now I can afford to say I'll charge you 9% because I don't care when you pay me off. You can pay me off next month, but I'm gonna get 8-9% while I hold this note. No fear of getting that principal payment back. Pretty cool. So that's something I really want to make sure we understand can happen. And this whole document, I'll send in this on also. It's about how we structure those types of transactions, okay? Now, remember this also. The note, if I carry it straight away from the close and it's taxable, does not receive that step up in basis that Dan's family gets. It's going to be fully taxable to the estate when they receive the principal payments. But how I structured it with cash and the basis being 100% and they did a 1031 exchange, that note is not taxable ever. So the basis in the property they bought does get a step up, thus saving that family another tens of thousands of dollars in taxes. Kind of crazy, okay? So it's really an interesting scenario. So that's that. And the last one's going to be, I did it again. Hold on a second. Go back to share. I want to go to partnership issues because you guys are going to be dealing with this an awful lot, I would think. Okay, partnership issues. A partnership would be, Dan, like your trust. There's a bunch of people, individual taxpayers in an entity that's not them. The trust is that entity. That entity could be an LLC. It could be a corporation. It could be an S corporation. But it's an entity that all the individuals are in. Okay, there's two ways to own the property. One is as a partnership or as a group, or other ways is called tenants in common. So Natalie, Dan, and I could go buy a property together, and Natalie and Dan's 50% are tenants in common with Doug. We each own 50% of the property, undivided interests. So in that state, if we sell it, you can do an exchange for your 50%. I can do an exchange for my 50%, unrelated to each other. But if we decide that after we bought the property, you know, we can get some additional tax benefits if we form a partnership and contribute our properties to the partnership, which you can do. And now the property is in a partnership. We're not individuals anymore. We each own 50% of a partnership.
When we sell that property, unfortunately, the partnership has to do the exchange. Well, unfortunately, like most cases, Natalie and Dan, you guys got married in high school. I knew you in high school. We were all best friends. But guess what? We're not best friends anymore because we're investing together. We got to go. We got to go our separate ways. Okay. And if you're in that partnership, we can't divide. We can't go our separate ways. How we structure this, at least if we can do it well in advance of the sale of the property, if we know we're not getting along, we know we're going to sell the property at least a year and a day before we sell the property, you know, two tax cycles, if we can, we'll drop out of the partnership as individuals, tenants in common, respective to our percentage ownership. And we'll own that property that way and sell it. Natalie and Dan and Doug are sellers, not the partnership. That way we can each exchange and go our separate ways and have fun with this thing. One thing also to remember for our syndicators out there and all of our people putting deals together inside these partnerships, listen carefully. The laws changed in 2018. It used to be that if you're a syndicator, you're probably the minority owner of the partnership. Usually you're the 5 to 10% owner. And you're doing pretty well at that 5 to 10% because you're using everybody else's money to make money. But when it comes time to sell that property, it used to be that if more than 50% of the partnership divided, the partnership automatically dissolved, meaning that you couldn't do an exchange. The laws have changed. As long as one partner remains and there's two partners in the partnership, irregardless of the value, the partnership can survive to do a 1031. So let's say we got 20 of us in a partnership and I decide it's time to sell it as a general partner. The general partner and but 10 of the other partners want to stay representing 30% of the partnership, but the other 70% just want their money. Give them their money at the close. The partnership, if we want to stay together, can stay together to go do another deal and not pay taxes. That's where the law changed. It's called 708B1B, and that law changed in 2018, and that's been a really powerful tool for my syndicators. Now, here's the issues with the partnerships. I'm going to send this along too, and the five solutions we have to take care of them, and I think it'll be helpful for you. Again, I took a little bit too much time. I do apologize, but I hope it was helpful, and I'll be here if you need me. Is there any questions right now?
No, we actually did that with one of our syndications where one of the investors didn't want to participate in the syndication, so we bought her out.
Yeah.
And then we continued
it is, right the here. Syndication. And by the way, you can do a 1031 exchange and buy out a partner. Okay, mm-hmm. Remember that. That's important. You can't buy from a related party, but you could buy a partner out. Okay?
Right.
Fantastic. Mm-hmm. Good job. Hey, thanks for having me on.
Yeah, absolutely. Anybody have any questions? Before we let Doug go, I mean, this is a lot of information. There's, you know, 1031s is a tool for us to use, right? So reach out to Doug, but even now, when you don't have a property under contract or when you're not thinking of, because having the knowledge and understanding what it is that you can do with a 1031 and how to apply it can actually help create new strategies for you. Can help create strategies for you to buy and to sell a property. When are we going to get the slides? As soon as Doug sends them to me, I'll send them over to everyone. Okay.
Very good. There it is.
Yeah.
All right, guys.
Awesome, guys. Any other questions? Doug, thank you so much for being on. Before we go, hold on. Before we go, I have to share my screen now so that next week I have one of my partners coming on. Hold on. And we're going, take out your phones and register now for next week. Click on that QR code. I've got Biff Ramsey coming on next week, and we're going to be discussing asset management. Biff has been in the asset management world for over 20 years. He's got 25,000 units under his belt. Managed Blackstone, Abu Dhabi Investment Authority, Merrill Lynch. These are billion-dollar portfolios. This guy is the best of the best when it comes to asset management. And I hear a lot of people talking, oh, I'm just going to asset manage the property myself, or I'm just going to be the asset manager or asset managing. If you've never been an asset manager, if you've never been a property manager, you have no idea what you're doing. So how could you be an asset manager? You don't know what you don't know. So
register now. Come, it's going to be a Q&A. Bring your questions, and we're going to dive into exactly what is asset management and how to manage the manager. All right? With that being said, everybody, I look forward to seeing you guys next week. Shoot me an email. And have a great rest of your evening. Doug, thanks again. Appreciate you. Yeah. And we'll be in touch.
Thank you, Doug.
Thanks, guys.
Thank you, guys. Have a good one. Take care.
Thank you, Nathan.